It was the scene and the sound that defined a decade.
It was probably, in my humble opinion, the most liberated period in the history of the world.
The music just pumped your soul.
From Saturday Night Fever.
When I first met John, he was doing the Barbarina. I wanted him to be Valentino, not Barbarino.
The white boy that could dance. I said, hallelujah, there's hope after all.
To Studio 54.
Studio 54 was like a fantasy, man.
300 people having sex up in the balcony.
I sort of vaguely remember being on the bottom of a pile of bodies one night, looking up and seeing Liza Minnelli over there and saying, what? Where am I? What am I doing?
Some kid went by me and popped a popper in my nose, and I went,
The party raged white hot.
There was hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of cocaine just floating around.
People just thought there were no limits and no boundaries.
All they did was each other and do drugs.
Until the music stopped.
We began to overindulge in such a way that a lot of us had dire consequences.
I ended up eventually becoming an addict, and it took me a long time to get over it.
I lost many friends to AIDS from needles and lifestyles.
These are the stories of disco's rise.
There was a camaraderie between people of all nationalities, all races, all creeds that didn't exist before then.
And fall.
A DJ asked everybody to bring in some records and let's burn them and let's kill disco.
Told by the people who lived it.
If you're thinking you're too cool to boogie, get on up on the floor, because we're going to boogie, oogie, oogie till you just can't boogie no more. Now get up!
When disco ruled the world.
In a world where only
hairballs,
soul,
and self-control was a crime,
our days were taken over and turned into Saturday nights.
And so began a time of pure
polyester,
where only
the diva's
brain and
boogie
was the name of the game.
When disco ruled the world.
When I think of disco, I think of it's just one big party.
Music just pulsating and just pounding.
Music that moves me to want to dance.
What images come to my mind when I think of disco?
Platform shoes.
Lots of eye makeup.
Silk and satin shirts opened up.
Bell-bottom pants.
A lot of drugs.
Cocaine.
Cocaine.
I don't know. Was there drugs around then?
There was a lot of sex going on.
Gay, straight, male, female.
It was a total out of control hedonistic sex situation.
Mirror balls. Really good DJs.
Dance floors with so many lights over them, you could smell the bulbs burning.
A nightclub.
It was people coming together. It was mad.
Disco era really began, you could say, in the late 60s.
It just seemed dark. I'd never felt anything like it.
And the Vietnam War was still on.
The assassination of Martin Luther King and all that. It was a very strange time for everybody.
At that point, you couldn't come out and say you were gay. People would look at you like you had the X on you. They had to find a place to go, so they banded together.
There was the Stonewall riots in the village, which changed the cabaret laws because it was illegal for two men to dance together until those riots in 1969. All of a sudden, men were able to dance with men and women could dance with women, and it just became a time when people just saw, well, let's experiment with this, let's see where this goes.
When the 70s came in, it was sort of the celebratory decade. The Vietnam War ended, we were making forward movement in the civil rights campaign, the women's movement, the gay movement.
I think people were ready at that time.
They needed somewhere to go and just not think about anything and just be happy and have fun and release.
The clubs in those days, in the early 70s, were like La Jardine.
The Sanctuary.
The Loft. The Loft was pretty much one of the first nightclubs in New York City.
The dance floor would get so crowded that you were shoulder to shoulder with everyone else.
Music at the Loft was dance music. Anything from James Brown to Temptations.
There were a lot of fabulous gay clubs like the 12 West.
Paradise Garage.
Flamingo.
Flamingo. Oh, Flamingo. What a membership it was. It was a who's who of the gay world. You had to be ready for the experience.
Some of my favorite places was like the gallery.
People would bring tambourines, shakers, maracas. They would scream and yell and chant. They would have spiritual experiences on the dance floor. People used to call the gallery church.
I remember one club that had mirrors all around, and I became fascinated just dancing with myself in the mirror.
Feeling love in the room.
It was called the Infinity.
Beams of light hit the mirrored balls and bounced them back and forth and off the mirrors. You couldn't tell where the club began and ended. It truly was infinity.
I started going to New York to go to clubs like the Infinity, seeing what the DJs were playing there, and seeing what the scene was like.
I remember one night I was at one of the heavy, heavy transvestite clubs, and I was at a urinal, and I looked to either side of me, and there were like three Diana Rosses, and they were all taller than me. And that's where I got the concept for the song I'm Coming Out by Diana Ross.
The word disco probably refers to the music, and I always felt that the music was the reason for disco to begin with.
Disco basically started in New York, spread to Miami, Chicago, San Francisco. It's mainly the big cities.
The stuff that sort of changed my life were groups like the Tramps and Lolita Holloway and MFSB, all of the great stuff from Philly.
Philadelphia sound was a little bit on the sophisticated side with strings.
I call it classical disco.
The Miami sound was more of a rhythm, groove, beat sound.
Sound of Miami came out of a little recording studio record company in Florida called TK Records, which was owned by Henry Stone.
And I made a lot of good R&B records that also had a very good dance beat.
He discovered George McRae, who did Rock Your Baby.
And that was written by Harry Casey, you know, Casey and the Sunshine Band.
Harry Wayne Casey loved to hang around my little studio. And I put him together with a young engineer. And that's how Rock Your Baby was born.
As I was writing, I was thinking about, you know, really a mother's love.
The first time I heard it, I just was overwhelmed.
It was number one in every country in the world.
It got everybody crazy because nobody ever heard a record like that.
It was the first real disco record that really launched the whole disco era.
It kind of changed what the norm of music was.
After Casey wrote Rock Your Baby, that's what kind of awoke me to the fact that Casey was a terrific artist.
Casey and the Sunshine Band was formed actually in 1973. I went to some of the studio musicians from TK Studios and I said, why don't we just become the band?
Back when Casey and the Sunshine Band came out, I think may have been the beginning of when white started doing black music in the disco era.
Basically, their stuff was very animalistic soul.
That's what I like, was just trying to describe these inner feelings and inner emotions within myself and just saying, that's the way I like it.
He had a lot of colorful musicians behind him, too, to help keep that up.
In the very beginning, the pop stations didn't touch it. But later on, through the clubs and the R&B charts, I forced the pop stations into playing Casey and the Sunshine Band.
That was the one thing I loved about disco music. There was a camaraderie between people of all nationalities, all races, all creeds. That didn't exist before then.
And I think finally in the 70s, it felt like we were living it now instead of dreaming about it.
White people turning on the black music.
People realized, yeah, this is what we need right now.
When disco came out in the early to mid-70s, you really did not hear it.
Disco wasn't played much at all on the radio stations.
People wanted to hear that stuff on radio, but radio wasn't picking up on it yet.
They just stepped to their rock and roll top 40 music back then.
By the mid-1970s, disco was ready to come out from the underground.
The clubs were very instrumental in popularizing disco music.
The DJs became more important than the radio.
Being a DJ when I first started out was really cool. Didn't pay a lot of money, but you met a lot of girls, you got a lot of drinks for free.
The DJ ruled the night.
I remember having sex in my sound booth for the first time. I was the king.
Disco DJs were responsible for
almost any good dance record broken in the clubs.
I'd get them first from the record label and I'd play them.
People would hear it in the club and then run to the record store and try to buy it.
Some of the album covers were designed with a lot of sexual overtones in it. Albums like Love and Kisses, there was a girl in the front with a ripped t-shirt with half her chest out.
Each one was trying to outdo the next.
The album covers sold sex.
And immediately they become hits.
Back then, the clubs made the artists.
These discotheques that were popping up were going to need music that was going to be good for dancing, specifically for dancing. So I determined that I would supply them with this music as best I could.
Femininity ruled in the 70s.
There were so many great divas. Their music was incredible.
I wanted to sing right out of high school, but it's a very difficult business. So I took up business courses, typing and shorthand, and then I took up cosmetology. I was performing in a club with a band. Sure enough, I was discovered by a producer. My love for disco music came primarily with Barry White. It made you want to move your body. And then I started to make my own.
At that time, most songs were 3 minutes long, and I said, you know, I'm going to try to elongate this thing.
So people could dance continuously from song to song.
And that great idea came with Gloria Gaynor's record, Never Can Say Goodbye.
The songs segued one into another seamlessly for a whole side of the recording.
It was almost 90 minutes long.
I was a little bit miffed because there was so much music without my vocal.
And she goes, I don't sing much. And I went, well, I guess you have to brush up on your dancing.
I never can say goodbye.
I'd never gone to a club where they played the same record for almost 2 hours. And I said, this is incredible.
Gloria Gaynor helped put disco on the map.
She absolutely drove the crowd to a frenzy. When she would sing, you could just feel electricity in the air.
And then you put on a Gloria Gaynor album or a Gloria Gaynor recording, the dance floor immediately became crowded.
Donna Summer is a pioneer of disco. She definitely is.
I always wanted to do a sexy song, and Donna said, how about the title, Love to Love You Baby? But when I told her that she has to moan a little bit, of course fake it, she didn't really feel that comfortable.
Back then, people weren't taking that many risks.
So I took the light down so she could not even see me, and in one take we did those famous, I don't know how many moans.
Love to Love You Baby, 14 minutes and 31 seconds.
There was over 5 minutes of the song with her just moaning, portraying an orgasm.
I thought it was great. I thought her having an orgasm for 15 minutes was kind of incredible, and right on, Donna.
Spiritual, primal, artistic, sexy, wrapped into one package.
I thought, I don't have the nerve to do that.
There was something about the music that made you want to dance.
One, two, three.
Disco was all about the dancing.
Everybody wanted to be a great dancer.
I was always into dancing and learning all the new dance steps, and I was like obsessed with it.
It was the thing to do.
It made you feel connected with a group.
There was the bump, which was my favorite.
You didn't have to learn how to dance to do the bump. You just had to bump your rear end against somebody.
You could get hurt if you do it too hard.
And the bus stop was a huge dance back then because it was easy to do.
But the hustle, I think, was the biggest disco dance of that whole era.
Everybody did the hustle.
Every time there was a dance, they had to have a theme song for that dance, and Bam McCoy's The Hustle was it.
It just had this infectious beat to it that made you want to do the hustle.
It was the first time since the Jitterbug that couples were actually holding hands and dancing again.
Dancing became totally different. You knew who was dancing with whom because you held hands.
That gave me a chance to do all my twirling on the dance floor and still be hip with it.
I started dancing the hustle. I started going to clubs for the women.
I was working new clothing stores. My sister used to go to all these dance clubs. And of course, my mom would say, hey, take your brother with you. You know, she was like, oh my gosh. And I would end up winning the dance contest.
If a great dancer came into the discotheque, I mean, it was like the water party.
guys looked up to you because you could dance, and the women loved it because you could move.
I mean, people, they would just stare at this person.
I would walk in, and people would go, hey, there's that guy that can dance.
And the minute they start dancing, people will hover around them and create this huge circle just to watch this person dance. I mean, it was exciting. It was like a show.
One of the things that made it so intense was all that testosterone boogieing around there.
I like to get out there and do splits and Russian leaps, and the girls would be, you know, they'd be giggling and smiling, and their eyebrows would be going up, and I was the king. He's the greatest
dancer. Dancing made the discotheques popular, and everyone got in the swing of it.
You'd come home and take your hand out of your pocket and drop 25 numbers on your label.
You wanted to be cool back in the disco era. You went to discos, you wore the right clothes, you learned the right dance steps.
The dance floor was happening. It was cool.
People danced all night. You were in fantasy land. You could do whatever you want. Everybody felt free to dance.
It was a party every weekend.
By the mid-70s, disco was just bubbling under, and it was going to explode big time.
Disco was just too good to keep in the closet. So it had to get out.
Everybody started gravitating to the music, the style of the clothes, the dancing.
People just loved it. They couldn't have enough of it.
By 1977, disco started to enter the mainstream with the movie Saturday Night Fever.
Now there was a movie to go see that had the music in it that we were dancing to.
Saturday Night Fever was about a cocky guy named Tony Manero who decides to join a dance contest with his girlfriend.
It was the closest thing to our lives that was documented on film.
I played Stephanie Mangano, who was your basic Italian princess from Brooklyn. The character of Tony Manero was played by an actor named John Travolta.
When I first met John, he said, listen, I already know how to dance. He was doing the Ba 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 Barbarino. I wanted him to be Valentino, not Barbarino. So when I started teaching him some of the moves, I used to take him out to the clubs. Pretty soon, he was getting so good, women would line up just to dance with him. And they would all giggle at the table, and he'd be doing the turn and and shaking the hips. John kept falling into this rhythm where he'd point up and down and shake the hips. I said, you know, John, it's wrong, but it looks good on you.
John Travolta was a white boy that could dance. I said, hallelujah, there's hope after all.
That made John Travolta a huge star.
He made polyester famous.
Everyone loved their polyester, their three-piece suits. The hair was a major thing back then.
We just washed the hair.
You had to put enough hairspray in there, so when you'd walk into a club, it was the same way when you left.
I work on my hair a long time, and you hit it. It hits my hair.
I used to think of myself as someone who's sort of nerdy and lame or not cool. So when I saw Saturday Night Fever and I saw that a guy could work in a hardware store carrying paint down the street by day, and at night he could dress up and be cool and dance to this sexy music, I thought, I think I could do that.
Saturday Night Fever was a hit because of the music.
The music was incredible.
The Bee Gees had numerous hits from the movies.
The Bee Gees, oh. I love the Bee Gees.
Saturday Night Fever was one of the best records ever.
I didn't know anybody that didn't have one.
Saturday Night Fever brought disco across the United States.
We knew that there was something really huge in our world that we could tap into.
That's when disco went mainstream.
It was such a strong cult thing that it just changed everybody. Swept over the world, fashions, music, nightclubs, everything.
It took everybody by storm.
People were opening up clubs left and right and center.
There was so many clubs back then. The biggest club by far, bar none, was Studio 54.
Studio 54, which was totally incredible, totally insane.
I did go to Studio 54. I don't remember much.
Studio 54 opened in New York, May of 1977, and skyrocketed immediately with the tremendous success of Saturday Night Fever.
This was the former TV studio on 54th Street, which Steve Rubell and Ian Schrager transformed into the hot club du jour.
At Studio 54, you had the great designer Halston, who was there every night, and Liza Minnelli, and all of the great celebrities would be there.
People like Andy Warhol and Truman Capote and Francesco Scabullo.
Grace Jones, Cher would be there. Frank Sinatra would come to the club.
Woody Allen with Michael Jackson. God knows what they were talking about.
You'd see a lot of people, and a lot of people would see you.
Bianca was like a fanatic. She just lived in the club.
Bianca Jagger's birthday was fantastic. Unfortunately, I had to pop out of a cake.
We brought this white horse with Lady Godiva on it. And at one point, Bianca decided to jump on top of the horse around the dance floor.
And then all of a sudden, from nowhere, 45 photographers.
Studio 54 was like a fantasy, man. Just took you out, took you to another place.
I sort of vaguely remember being on the bottom of a pile of bodies one night. I remember looking up and seeing Liza Minnelli over there and thinking, where am I? What am I doing?
I was hanging out with Michael Jackson, and he turned to me and he said, where am I?
It was a really, really wild scene.
I came there one night. The doorman came over and said, Miss Gaynor, you don't want to come in here tonight. And we got back into the car and drove away. I don't know what was going on in there, but apparently he didn't think that it was something that I would be pleased with.
The amount of sex that took place at Studio 54 was absolutely unbelievable.
I mean, if you really want to be candid, I mean, I've seen people get upstairs right there, live. And in color.
300 people having sex up in the balcony.
It was before AIDS, and nobody was concerned about having casual sex and dying.
The busboys at Studio 54 were half naked and walked around in little satin shorts.
Stevie Rebell was running around with a stack of Polaroids of every single busboy and bartender masturbating to show the size of the genitals to Halston and the other gay celebrities and saying, which one do you want tonight?
The whole club was built around sex and drugs.
In the basement, it was kind of Steve Rubell's secret VIP room for celebrities where they did drugs.
It was just a den of iniquity down there. All they did was f*** each other and do drugs.
Marijuana, quaaludes.
A lot of hallucinogens.
Poppers were involved.
I remember being out on the floor one night dancing. Some kid went by me and popped a popper in my nose, and I went, Cocaine had a major part in Studio 54.
Oh, it's definitely the white lady. Cocaine was fashionable, and they didn't think it was addictive.
The free sex, the free drugs, that was a draw of the club.
I think the most important element of the success of a place like Studio 54 was how they picked people to go in.
Not everybody could get into that club.
Studio 54 had a velvet rope. They picked people out from behind the rope. And if they didn't like the people, they wouldn't choose them.
And they would select the beautiful people, and the rest were out left, screaming in the street.
They would look at you, and it was almost like, no, we have one of those. Thank you very much. Next.
The whole idea of the success was the element of the crowd and the mix, kind of like a tossed salad, Steve Rebell used to call it.
There were nights when I tried to get in and couldn't for some odd reason, and I was ruined. I was this close to suicide.
There was a definite effort by people like Stevie Rebell to put the individual down. They often had me turn away the celebrities.
I can remember turning away Warren Beatty.
I remember once I tried to get into Studio 54 and they wouldn't let me in. But I'm Carolyn Gorney from Saturday Night Fever. And they just didn't know you're not.
Grace Jones invited us to Studio 54. They didn't let us in.
Niall starts, you know, screaming all sorts of obscenities and stomps off into the night.
So we went to my apartment, which was around the corner, and we started jamming on this little riff. And it was like, great. Now we got to make this song called Off and try and get it on the radio.
So instead of saying off, he says freak out. And it became like a monster hit.
I was able to get in, but I really resented the fact that there were so many people that were not able to get in. It's like, well, how are you deciding? They're going by how you look. Okay, well, you're too short, you're too tall, you're too black, you're too light. Personally, I had a problem with that.
That wasn't right. That was like taking a step backwards.
Stevie Rebell would say to the girl, right in the middle of the winter, you take off your shirt and you stand here without your shirt for half an hour, I'm going to let you in. And the girl would immediately strip. Stevie would just be giggling. And, you know, she had to go to the hospital. She had frostbitten nipples.
People would sneak in, but it was difficult. They'd go to all lengths.
There was a guy that had gotten stuck in the grate, and he had tried to come through from the building next door and got stuck. And he died, and he was dressed in black tie.
People just thought there are no limits and no boundaries.
There was no place else for a disco to go but down. In 1978, disco was really at its peak.
In the past, the discos, it was sort of a secret, but it expanded greatly with Studio 54.
Kept thinking I could never live without you by my side.
When I Will Survive first came out, my favorite club to perform in really was Studio 54.
When that song would come on, you would see women out there, six, seven, eight of them dancing together, mouthing the words and singing.
I just walked in to find you here with that look upon your face.
The response was phenomenal.
I think a lot of people identified with that feeling. They were hurt by someone.
This was something that really gave them a chance to express themselves even more than ever.
Walk out the door. Just turn around now.
I was one of the few artists that would perform on the catwalk as it moved out across the audience. It was almost like the queen above her subjects, just loving them and having them love her.
Too much of anything is, you know, bad.
After a while, disco was everywhere. It was too omnipresent.
It just crisscrossed all over the country.
I worked at a club in Buffalo called the Club 747. It was the inside of a 747 jumbo jet. They used the interior from the windows to the seats. People from all over the world came to that nightclub when they went to Buffalo or when they came to see Niagara Falls.
Things started to get more, in some ways, commercial.
I really think that that probably had as much of a negative effect on the movement as a positive effect.
They're discoing up everything, from Burger King ads.
Let's disco to Burger King.
To car ads.
You hear it in the bank. You hear it at the airport.
You couldn't find a television show that wasn't talking about disco.
Disco Step by Step was the first television show that actually was dedicated to disco music, dance instruction, and hustle dancing.
Grandmothers, grandfathers, the mothers and fathers, the aunts and uncles were tuning. Even the little kids liked it.
Every week it tuned in to Dance Fever with Denny Terrio.
I said, you know, Merv, I said, we ought to have a dance contest. He thought about it for a minute. He goes,
why don't I take my show and one night have America's first disco contest with contestants? And we'll give him a prize.
He called me the next day, and it was the highest ratings he had had in 13 years on television.
It was absolutely amazing. So I said, let's do this as a weekly show. And thus was born Dance Fever.
I remember one show that this girl had a pair of pantyhose on with nothing on under it and did a split. You know, and we were all in the room going, oh, my gosh.
Dance Fever caught on because it really was the public dancing.
It had this wonderful feeling of 15 minutes of fame.
What we decided to do, rather than having a show where everybody is just dancing to a record, we filled our show with guest stars. We called it Disco Magic. We wanted Vicky Sue Robinson. She had the biggest hit in the country, Turn the Beat Around.
Turn the beat around. Love to hear percussion.
And RCA Records said, I'll tell you what, we'll give you Vicky Sue, but we've got this new up-and-coming group called Village People. And nobody had heard of them yet. We were the first show to ever put them on television. And that was pretty exciting.
The Village People were the quintessential disco group.
They were a pop group. I looked at them as a pop group.
Marketable, commercial. It's like a formula thing.
Six guys up there doing their thing in their little tight pants.
Each night we would try to see which one of the characters was more imitated. Were there more construction workers? Were there more cowboys? Were there more Indians?
It's almost like they're cartoons.
They were like a caricature of everything that the club scene was supposed to be about.
They did YMCA in the Navy.
Everybody's joining the Navy after In the Navy came out.
I don't think the Navy is listening to the words of In the Navy.
Join your fellow man.
I never played YMCA. I never played Macho Man in my club. It's just commercial.
Disco really saturated the music industry.
At that time, disco was really the only thing that would get you on radio. First one in fact only made one disco record, and that disco record we made was called Boogie Wonderland. We just wanted to just like put our stamp on one commercial's hit and forget about it.
Blondie was sort of really more from the rock world. I don't think that we ever really considered ourselves a disco group. We felt that we had done some things that were crossover and worked in both worlds. And so much the better for us. We always called Heart of Glass a disco song. Some of our friends from different rock bands were very put off by the fact that we did this disco song and wanted us to be driven out of town or driven out of the business, at least.
Everybody tried their hand at a disco song, but not all of them were real successful.
When Rod Stewart and the Rolling Stones start doing disco songs, you know, you're gonna have some repercussions.
Everybody jumped on the bandwagon.
Aretha Franklin, Dolly Parton,
Frank Sinatra,
Ethel Merman.
Who wanted to hear Ethel Merman's disco album? No one.
There's no business like show business, like no business I know.
When they did a disco version of Ethel Merman singing There's No Business Like Show Business, I knew it was over.
By 1979, disco was actually starting to die.
Studio 54 got so big and so popular and so high profile, Ian Schrager and Steve Rebell were making millions and millions of dollars in cash.
Steve Rebell started feeling like he wanted to push the envelope in every sense.
There was hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of cocaine just floating around the club.
Disco kind of opened up the drug world to a lot of people.
Just getting extremely stoned and just jumping up and down.
A little snort here and a little snort there.
There was this tremendous rush to do cocaine, and the only place people could find it was at Studio 54.
A lot of people were really high and tripping.
I ended up eventually becoming an addict, and it took me a long time to get over it. But I can tell you that I was introduced to all these things in the clubs.
I didn't get into drugs until around the time of Studio 54, which is where it all became overwhelming for me.
The low points of disco were the decadence with the drug abuse. It really became a bad epidemic.
You know, you never thought you'd have to pay a price.
The whole movement got caught up in scandals and people going to jail.
Stevie Rebell and Ian Schrager were indicted for tax evasion and for possession of huge amount of cocaine.
They made so much cash, they were just bragging about how much money they made. The only problem is the IRS heard them bragging.
Steve went on TV and he said he made more money than the mob.
The club was eventually raided.
The day that they got busted, must have been 100 FBI agents there. It was exciting because I wasn't responsible. And I'll never forget this. Roy Cohn walks in, and I remember saying to him, he goes, what, they won't let you go to the bathroom? You go wherever you want. And I was like, yeah, that's right, my lawyer, Roy Cohn.
When Steve Rebell and Ian Schrager were sent to jail, that was the end of Studio 54.
An era ended when Studio 54 closed and Sly Stallone bought the last drink.
Disco became a dirty word back around the end of 1979.
It was all of a sudden the music you love to hate.
People started to turn on disco.
A Taste of Honey was playing an Air Force base, and we just knew everyone was going to dance because we were playing all the latest songs, but no one danced.
It wasn't cool anymore to listen to disco.
I put my hand on my hip, and my head got to going. If you're thinking you're too cool to boogie, get on up on the floor because we're going to boogie, oogie, oogie till you just can't boogie no more. Now get up!
Get on up on the floor, cause we're gonna boogie, oogie, oogie till you just can't boogie no more.
I'm thinking disco was actually starting to die, and if we were not careful, we were gonna die with it.
People were really getting disgusted with the word disco and the trend and everything. It was becoming a laughable thing.
We had that song, Disco Duck.
Rick Dees recorded a song called Disco Duck, meaning even a duck could sing a disco song.
That was the worst song I ever heard in my life.
It was a little out there.
You know, come on, I'd smash that record.
There was a Sesame Street disco album.
It had to stop. Big Bird should not be doing the bump.
It just was totally out of hand.
It becomes something that was a parody of itself.
They started, like, experimenting with movies like Roller Boogie.
Yeah, I do remember some of the roller disco films, yeah. Not my cup of tea.
Olivia Newton-John did Xanadu.
God, what was that movie about?
There was a Village People movie called Can't Stop the Music, but by that point, nobody even paid attention.
People were just fed up with this whole movement.
Everybody wanted to stop the music. It was pure cheese.
When disco music got so popular that mainstream artists from pop music began to do disco music, that is what brought about this disco sucks thing.
Whatever goes up must come down. Eventually, you're going to have a backlash.
The rock and rollers back then had an animosity towards people who listened to disco.
Death to disco was a real sort of signature for a lot of the rock artists because they felt like it was sort of being crammed down their throats.
The backlash against disco happened in the stadium in Chicago where a DJ asked everybody to bring in some records and let's burn them and let's kill disco.
A huge box containing thousands of disco records was blown up at Chicago's Comiskey Park.
That 1979 disco demolition made no sense at all.
That was like psycho.
The disco demolition was kind of a culmination of a lot of hatred against disco that had been broiling in the public.
I thought that was so, so ridiculous. What did disco do to them?
If you don't like the music anymore, why don't you just turn it off?
The burning of all the records showed an animosity towards something else.
People just got tired of hearing the same thing. All the music sounded alike.
They were very much against the soft, colorful, feminine vibration within disco music.
What do you do with something that threatens you? You try to get rid of it.
Disco sucks was a homophobic, anti-Latin, anti-black point of view. That was sort of mindless vandalism.
Disco sucks is really an interesting choice of words for a homophobe.
It just felt really racist. It felt like book burning. It felt like Nazis.
You were afraid to now walk the streets, you know, and thinking some crazy punk rocker or somebody that broke a couple of those albums was going to take a swing at you, you know. It was scary.
The thing that hurt me the most as a result of the whole disco sucks backlash is all of a sudden we were being perceived as artists and people who suck. I had become persona non grata and people treated me like I had the plague or something. Hi, it's Nile Rodgers and the folk. I'm not here. You mean the disco Nile Rodgers? Oh, no, he's not here. It really hurt me.
The freedom back in the late 70s and the sexual revolution finally took its toll.
It was a great era until the demons took over.
Everybody was doing loose sex in those days. Protection was not telling your mother and father, that was protection.
People were having so much free sex, especially in the gay clubs, and it started to cross over into mainstream clubs.
We began to overindulge in such a way that we didn't even recognize that there were going to be consequences, and a lot of us had dire consequences.
AIDS came along.
1982 is when it really became an epidemic, a terrifying epidemic.
AIDS really helped devastate the disco industry.
I lost many friends to AIDS from needles and lifestyles.
When the plague came around, people didn't feel like having so much fun anymore.
And it was heartbreaking to send out a mailing and have one-third of it come back with deceased written on the envelopes.
All that fabulous, fabulous creative influence and energy of the gay world was coming to an end.
AIDS killed everybody.
That, to me, was the saddest and the lowest point of what happened in that great period of time. Oh, baby.
It was time for a change.
Back in the 80s, people were just looking for something new.
Rap music started to come into the scene pretty big.
When rap music came out, disco died, okay?
We started listening to releases from Sugar Hill. It was such great stuff.
The Sugar Hill Gang with Rapper's Delight changed the face of music.
Now what you hear is not a test. I'm rapping to the beat. And me, the groove, and my friends are gonna try to move your feet.
I thought to myself, wow. Something important is happening in music.
Something had stopped and something else had begun.
You could feel that the same power, the same earthquake that we hit with in the 70s was starting to happen again.
The disco era, for me, was just a real innocent time.
Everything was love.
All the rules went out the window. So let's dance.
Time to have to party, have a lot of fun.
There was no color line with disco.
Every single person out there was a star.
To me, it was a celebration and kind of letting go and enjoying life, you know, the way life should be enjoyed.
It was probably, in my humble opinion, the most liberated period in the history of the world.
I think the legacy of disco is that people are still listening to the good old songs, the disco songs.
I think disco is always going to be there in everybody's hearts.
Did disco rule the world?
Absolutely.
There's no question about it.
It most certainly did rule the world. And I think it did it very well.
Come on, come on, turn it up and dance with me, yeah.